Hi everyone, welcome back to the Communication and Conflict YouTube channel, promoting mindful communication, growth through conflict. So today's video is a follow-up to the last one which I did on bullying investigations. Bullying investigations can't work for anyone involved, using the ACAS guide to explain why, basically. So in that video I made reference to this guide produced by ACAS in the UK, the Advisory Conciliation and Arbitration Service. I got a bit tongue-tied when I tried to say the name last time, but I use the ACAS guide because it's kind of the most common go-to reference for dealing with bullying allegations, and I pointed out that when you try to approach bullying in the same way as you would harassment, it's not possible to achieve the same kind of clarity of outcome as you can with harassment, because harassment has a legal definition, bullying doesn't. Bullying has hundreds of definitions, you can find various ones all over the place. And the point is that bullying is very distinct from harassment, because harassment focuses on a protected characteristic of the individual, whereas bullying is almost always about a difficult relationship between two people. Now I was very clear in the video that none of what I'm saying is to try to dismiss the seriousness of the kind of incidents that are involved in situations which are often described as bullying, but what I was pointing out was that it's this need to prove that it's bullying before anything is done about the situation, which is the reason why almost all allegations of bullying and investigations into it don't get anywhere. And while it might have been that initially people were thinking I'm just making a kind of theoretical point, I also identified an example in Australia where they set up a particular branch of their judiciary to look into, to investigate, to specifically investigate allegations of bullying, and I pointed out that only 3 out of 701 investigations came to a clear conclusion, and I referred to another ACAS paper where that was mentioned, which is this one. I gave the details in the last video as well, and I'll perhaps put a link to these in the information below on this, but I would recommend, if you haven't seen the previous video, to see it. It does go on for quite a while, but my point was to go into detail as to why bullying allegations do not get people anywhere. And I don't mean this as just like, oh, it's a criticism, it's a conspiracy, etc., etc., which is a common kind of response to bullying allegation investigations getting nowhere. There's a common default to saying it's all a cover-up, it's all a conspiracy, it's that management don't care and things like that. And I would propose, really, it's just that the system that is kind of used by default across the globe, because this isn't just a UK issue, it's a kind of a global issue. In much of the literature can also be seen in Australia and America as well. It just doesn't work. The system doesn't work. So in a sense, even if organisations do try to apply it, they're very unlikely to come to any useful outcome from it, because this expectation that somehow you prove something is bullying before you do anything about it, which is an unnecessary loop, and it leads to what I call a circle of blame, where the person who feels bullied believes that they haven't been listened to or taken seriously simply because they can't prove that what they're experiencing is can be labelled bullying. The person who's accused doesn't feel that they've been kind of cleared of the allegation, because again there's no way of proving whether they were or they weren't bullying, because the criteria are so ambiguous. And the organisation that kind of commissions an investigation into it is accused of conspiracy, failure, incompetence, etc., because they're trying to work with something which is like trying to hold water in your hands. There's no clarity, you can't contain the description and the meaning of what bullying is, because it's a subjective experience between two people. Now, as I say, when I use the phrase subjective, sometimes people think that means that it therefore can be dismissed. And I'm not saying that for 1 minute. It's a significant experience for both people involved. Assuming it's just two people, sometimes it can be more, but quite often it's an allegation by one about another person. But it applies even if it's more people and more people. It's the issue of trying to define what bullying is, and then even though it's ambiguous and can't be kind of contained within a clear description, which harassment can be, because it can't be defined, it then means you're trying to work with something which actually, well, at the end of the day, nobody really knows what it is they mean by it. And that's not the basis for a formal process, a formal investigatory process. And so, as I say, I mean, you know, wherever you point the blame, in a sense, it doesn't fall anywhere. It's the system itself which is the issue, and it's not like there's one person who is causing that to be used. It's being used everywhere by the people who allege bullying. They want an investigation. The organisation that responds creates an investigation. Often the people who are accused of bullying want an investigation to prove, then to kind of clear themselves or to kind of meet the allegations made. So in a sense, everybody's responsible for wanting an investigation into bullying, but there's very little recognition of the fact that it just isn't going to get people anywhere. And as I say, I could argue this all day. What I would point to are the statistics. I think I've said before in the other video, if you're someone who's involved in a bullying allegation, you'll be very rare if it's come to a clear conclusion. Whoever you are, whether you're the person who's doing the investigation, whether you're the person who's accused of bullying, or whether you're the person who's alleged bullying, it's incredibly unlikely that you are involved in a process which has come to a clear outcome. You may argue for it to be so if you're the investigator, of course, because it's important that you can try to show that it has come to a clear outcome. But I would be very, very surprised if the people involved are willing to accept any form of clear outcome that you've come to, because it's a subjective experience. So therefore, how can it be put into a kind of clear box and say, yes, that was bullying? And further to that, as a further example, employment tribunals in the UK do not hear allegations of bullying. They will not have a hearing to hear an allegation of bullying. They will harassment, but they will not hear allegations of bullying because they've got no legal basis on which to make the assessment. So that's my summary of what I said in the last video. There are probably other things that will come up, but my point that I want to kind of make in this video is that there are ways of dealing with bullying allegations, but they're very rarely used. And it doesn't have to be mediation or conflict coaching, which are the things that I'm going to introduce and explain. It can simply be that a manager uses a particular approach to situations, and the people themselves involved use a particular approach to their situation, which enables there to be a movement towards resolution of the situation. And the benefit of using things like mediation and conflict coaching and a less formal approach to things is that it supports the maintenance of a relationship rather than an assumed breakup of the relationship with kind of repercussions afterwards. Now, I'm saying this on the basis of being a witness to and a facilitator of various workplace disputes which have been allegations of bullying, and people have resolved it. And the reason they've resolved it is that they haven't spent their time arguing whether something is or isn't bullying. They've simply addressed the particular behaviour and the experiences that have occurred without feeling this need to prove it's bullying first before they resolve it. So I started to give some examples in the last video, and I'll repeat some of them again, but in a sense what I say about any one of them is true about any behaviour which is considered to be bullying. So in a sense there's no end of examples I could give, but I'll give you repeat some of the examples I gave in the last one. So common examples can be perhaps someone who's an employee feels that their manager is kind of overbearing and too kind of pernickety and perhaps kind of over controlling of them just getting on and doing their work. And they feel embarrassed by that because they think it suggests they can't do their job properly, or they find it embarrassing that the manager keeps kind of pointing things out in the presence of other people as if it undermines their credibility. And they're obviously entirely understandable viewpoints to have. You know, you don't want to be someone working in an office or somewhere where the boss keeps coming up saying, you're doing that wrong, you're doing that wrong, or why are you doing that, or you're not doing that again, are you? Or whatever it is they're saying, you know, whatever it is that you're finding to be very too much, overbearing, overwhelming, unnecessary. You're capable at your job, you know how to do it, sometimes you make mistakes, but you can correct them. So why does your boss need to be standing over your shoulder over the time, pointing out these problems? So so that's your perspective. Obviously the boss's perspective is they want to make sure everything's done properly, on time, correctly. They're responsible for everybody's performance, so if they see anything not working properly, they're worried about the impact on other people, etc., etc. But that doesn't necessarily mean it's okay for them to deal with it in the way that they're dealing with it with you. But there's very unlikely to be any way of proving that's bullying. You know, at the end of the day, you could spend time trying to prove that that's bullying, but the chances are very low that that will get anywhere for the reasons I've already said. And you probably realize that yourself, but in situations you've probably resorted, if you have resorted to calling that bullying, it's because you don't feel there's any other way of you dealing with it, because the system set up in your organization say you either lump it or you make a formal complaint, and that's your only option. So there's this very narrow way of responding to difficulties in the workplace when you don't already have an effective kind of working relationship going on amongst everybody, that actually, yeah, you can address these things without it having to become a problem. But where it does become a problem, and the suggestion is that you have to make it formal, rather than it be via an investigation, it can be via mediation, or it can even be via one or both of you having conflict coaching, which is about supporting you in thinking through better ways of dealing with your own response to the situation. But if it was mediation, then obviously you get a chance, should you choose to come together to discuss it. And in that meeting, you get a chance to discuss, when I'm doing this and you're, you know, standing over me pointing out all my problems, what I'm doing wrong, I know I'm doing them wrong, I just need a bit of time and space to get on and fix them. I don't need you to be criticizing me all the time, I don't need you to be calling me incompetent in the presence of everybody else. You know, it doesn't help me, I can't imagine it helps you, etc. So these are the kinds of things that people are saying in mediations that I provide for people to be able to say these things. And sometimes, you know, it's a difficult conversation, they're pointing these things out, and you know, the other person saying, well, why do you keep getting it wrong, you know, I've got to make sure everybody's on time, you know, you keep giving me all this grief about it instead of just getting on and doing it correctly, that's why I stand up. So all this kind of stuff goes on in a mediation, and that's fine, that's absolutely fine, because people are sharing and talking about what it is that's not working for them. Because my question is always going to be, okay, what is it you both want to be different in the future that means this doesn't keep happening? So one person saying, okay, well, I get it wrong, I don't want him, her, standing over me just pointing out in front of everybody. Why can't we have a separate discussion? Why can't they give me a bit of time and trust that I get it done on time? And the other person gets a chance to say, well, you know, how do I know that's going to work? So it's like they then have this dialogue about, well, you know, if you don't do this, then it means that I can actually focus and I'm not spending my time worrying about if you're going to come into the room or not. Or if you really need to talk to me, take me into your office and we can have a chat about it then. Or send me an email or whatever it is. But don't do this thing of standing over me, pointing out my problems in front of everybody, because it's as if you're trying to humiliate me and embarrass me. And actually, in a way, that's starting to work. And if you're saying that's not what you're trying to do, then do it differently, because it's not working for me and I'm going to make it more formal if you don't. So all these kinds of things can be said, But they're talking about it, they're working out how to go forward. And whether begrudgingly or sometimes even in a more amicable sense, they create a different way forward. No one spent any time talking about whether it's bullying anymore. You'll notice in any of what I've just said, bullying wasn't mentioned once. It was what the thing was that happened. Now, I gave you an example of a manager who's perceived to be overbearing, that is perceived to be humiliating, undermining. That conversation wouldn't have to be about just that. It could be about other examples. I'm in meetings, you don't listen to what I say, I raise what I think are really valid points, but you completely ignore me, or you don't give me space to speak. That kind of thing can be raised. We were having a discussion about the project, and you started making personal criticism of me in the shared group discussion. That really is unnecessary and it's embarrassing. Why did you do that? That was particularly undermining and difficult for me. And it was particularly personal. You didn't have to be so personal about me. That kind of thing can be discussed. It doesn't have to be proven to be bullying before people move on and discuss the details of that situation and create a better way forward in both of their own interests. The person accused of bullying, often there's this suggestion of a power imbalance between a manager and employee. But what often people don't understand is that if an allegation of bullying is made about a manager, that's an incredibly threatening thing to do from their perspective. And some people might say, oh, good, I want them to be feeling that way. Well, if there is that attitude, then obviously there's the potential that actually the intention is to be bullying towards the boss in that case. And this is where we get these kind of complete go nowhere discussions. It's like, what is it you're both wanting? How can you take this forward? What do you both need to do for that to be possible? And any other questions that arise that support people in understanding each other's perspectives and why it's not working from their perspective. And that's on both sides. So the point about mediation is it's an impartial process. It's not representing one against the other. It's not treating one as a victim and one as a perpetrator. It's treating both as two people who are having a difficult experience in their workplace. And in their own interests, not to be nice to each other. They may not want to be nice to each other, but in their own interests, so that they're not spending time dealing with a bullying allegation or other formal procedures. In their own interests, they're coming together to work out a better way forward. And that can be a learning opportunity for both. For some people, it can be an opportunity for them to see, actually, I can address these problems with the boss. It's not as if you can't say these things to a boss. Your power dynamics, as are sometimes put forward as a reason why people can't say these things, which personally I don't agree with, because I see people regularly being very clear and assertive, even though they're in the employee position with a boss. They're entirely able to express themselves given the opportunity to do so. And part of the mediation process, if people are concerned about that, is to support them in thinking about how they can do so. So a lot of pre-discussion with people in the initial meetings we have before any joint meeting is about what will help you to express the things that you want to say. Sometimes people who've not spoken to their colleague, either boss or colleague, over a situation that has previously been described as bullying. Sometimes people haven't spoken to the other person for maybe a year and have actively avoided being in their presence because of concerns about how that interaction will go. So we can talk with them before coming to the joint meeting about how they might be able to express themselves, what they need to support themselves, what they need to know about the meeting that will mean they feel comfortable being able to turn up and do that. And there are various things that the mediation process provides intrinsically that support people being able to express themselves in an effective manner and in a constructive manner. And that can be true for both sides in the situation. The boss might want to discuss why in the past their discussions with the employee haven't gone well and what they would want to be different. And it may be that the mediation process itself supports that difference, or it may be that they want to address that problem with the other person. So all these things can be discussed in mediation, but it's just not used. It's very rarely used because of this almost unconscious default to thinking that because investigations are used for harassment and are much and are effective and appropriately so, because harassment is a very serious thing, there's this expectation that it will work for bullying, and it won't work for bullying because bullying is a much more subjective experience. It's not a clear discrimination towards another person on the basis of a characteristic of them that can be proven simply by virtue of the person's language and their kind of reasoning for doing things that they've done, simply on the basis of someone's gender or sexuality or religion or race or whatever is the identified characteristic that they're using to discriminate against the person. In bullying, provided there is no evidence of harassment, in which case obviously it would go down the formal route, and that's, you know, that's a given, that's not understood. But in most allegations of bullying, that is not the case. And I mean most allegations of bullying, that's not the case. And so in that enormous number of situations where bullying is alleged, and it's only alleged because that's the only option people are given in workplaces, you've got to make an allegation of bullying before we're going to even really bother to take anything that you say seriously. And it is this need to go through this loop of proving bullying before anything's taken seriously. So there isn't an option of mediation offered. There isn't an option of conflict coaching offered. There isn't a management approach which supports the likelihood of this being resolved without the need for any of that. When those approaches aren't present, when mediation, conflict coaching and management approaches aren't present, it defaults to this ineffective bullying approach, and then it goes nowhere other than to cause immense stress for everybody involved, and damage limitation exercises, etc., etc., by trying to perhaps keep the people apart, even though that's not an effective use of their skills and talents and capacities in the workplace. So this is why there are answers to bullying allegations. There are answers to difficult working relationships. It isn't the case that power dynamics mean that an employee cannot address with their manager their concerns over how their manager is treating them. It's a confidential, without prejudice discussion. There are different ways of responding to people's difficult behaviours towards us. If it is harassment, you have the protection of the law against that. But in most bullying allegations, there is no basis for taking further legal action. An employment tribunal will not deal with an allegation of bullying. It will only deal with an allegation of harassment, which is back to why I think the ACAS guide and other guides that put bullying and harassment together in the same document are very inappropriate, because they give this false representation of what will happen for bullying as if it's aligned with what will happen for harassment. And that leads to an enormous amount of false expectation that can't be met when it's a bullying allegation. So that's basically the point that I'm making, that if you seek to resolve difficult experiences at work through calling them bullying, you are almost guaranteed to get absolutely nowhere, whether you're the person who feels bullied, whether you're the person who's accused of bullying, or you're the organisation that is required to investigate it or sees within your procedures a necessity to investigate it, without a substantial commitment to trying to resolve it through something like mediation or one-to-one support of conflict coaching, etc. I think there's starting to be a recognition of this. I saw an article the other day which said that workplace disputes can't be resolved by anybody other than the people directly involved. So with the caveat that if the action is illegal, that's not the case. In all other working relationship breakdowns, it's down to the people involved to resolve it. It's not a manager's job to make people like each other. It's not a manager's job to make people get along with each other. It's the people themselves' jobs to work out why they're having difficulties working with each other and to resolve it in a mutually respectful, amicable, adult way. Because a bullying allegation, investigation, just will not work. So, I'm going to end it there. Please, as always, give me your thoughts and comments. Please share them in the section below. If you think other people might want to see this video, please share it to them, pass it over. Please like it, subscribe, etc., etc. You know the drill. Thanks for listening. Have a good day. Bye-bye.